Good Friday morning, everyone, and welcome to season three of The Backyard Naturalist. And boy, did season two end on a cliffhanger as we were all on the edges of our seats, clutching our popcorn to see what would happen with the conservation plan for the Urban Ecology Center. Well, hopefully season three will help tie up some of those loose ends and bring some closure to some thoughts, and most importantly, open up some new questions related to our backyard habitats. My name is Tim. I work at the Urban Ecology Center, and I'll be your host today as we look into the many mysteries of the common nighthawk in the season opener of season three, Nighthawk Down. This episode is hosted by the Urban Ecology Center. A big thank you to those of you who are supporting our mission by being a member, and a special thank you, as always, to the Backyard Naturalist subscribers. If you enjoy this time together on Friday mornings, I hope you'll consider supporting us, this community, through a subscription. For more details, you can contact anyone on the research team. And this is so hot off the press that you are the first to hear about it. The marketing team at the center just launched our online merchandise outlet, and we have a 20% off discount code for UEC members. This is a while supplies last outlet, so please feel free to stock up and some fashionable and practical swag, as we may not be restocking these same items in the future. For details, please see the not yet released member email coming to you early next week, because you're hearing this first, folks. Or you can contact membership manager Glenna Holstein for details. Also, tomorrow is the third installment of the Backyard Birding Blitz. This program was created in response to the stay-at-home orders from early 2020. But it has been so enjoyable, we have decided to make it an annual fall birding event. All you need to do is go look for birds on or about tomorrow morning, that's Saturday, September 4th, without using fossil fuels in the process, and submit your list to be eligible for a $50 gift certificate to Bottle House 42 here in Milwaukee. We'll also go over the benefits of using eBird, and we'll host a bird trivia session. So again, contact any member of the UEC's research team for details. And finally, next week, same time, same channel, the Backyard Naturalist featured group of organisms will be one that you've all been waiting for, one of the most iconic groups we've ever featured. They're in stories, fairy tales, movies, books. They're feared, loved, and revered. And I'm talking, of course, about the protozoa, seen here in a tight feeding formation in the deep blue medium in which they're housed. So if you don't love protozoa after next week, I haven't done my job. Okay, so on to today's featured critter, the common nighthawk. What do we know about it? It's not a hawk, it's not nocturnal, and it's not common. So big shout out to whoever gave this bird its name, because it's none of those things. So since the words don't describe it very well, photos don't lie, and we can just take a moment to revel in the awkward and striking beauty of the common nighthawk. And we'll come back to this picture again, so don't worry. But words do matter. And if we move away from the common English name, at least the colloquial one that's accepted by the American Ornithologists Union, it gets better. It gets much better. So first of all, where does the nighthawk fit in the tree of life? It's a eukaryotic animal with a backbone and feathers, the modern dinosaur group we call birds. And among the birds, it fits in the order Caprimulgiformes, also known as the nightjars. You may not have heard the word Caprimulgiformes, but you've probably heard of the root word of the first part, capra, in another context. Capricorn is the sign of the goat, which has nothing to do with birds. But then if you add the second part of the word, mulgi comes from the root word to milk, or more appropriately, to suck milk from. And so the translation of the family is the goat suckers. And I remember early on in college when when we started learning, you know, family names of birds and just getting a kick out of the list, because you have your hawks, your ducks, your swifts, your hummingbirds, your woodpeckers, and your goat suckers. And many bird references use this common word still today. So why are these birds called the goat suckers? Goat suckers. It's actually based on a superstition from over 2,000 years ago. So at a glance, if you look at the bills of your goat suckers, they're actually quite tiny, quite small, if you look front to back, and it doesn't really look like they could suck on anything. But when they open up that bill, you just see how unbelievably impressive they are side to side. And now you can start to understand their capability of sucking on goat teats. And this unbelievably wide mouth is an adaptation to a lifestyle of being an aerial insectivore, or eating insects while flying. So essentially, they use this mouth like a giant net, opening it wide while they're flying through the air to catch insects, very similar to how a basking shark uses its wide mouth to trap plankton when it's swimming. And this adaptation is so specialized that, according to a colleague of mine in the animal rehab business, these birds don't really have a mechanism for swallowing. The insect just goes straight into the stomach of the flying open mouth bird. So if they get an injured nighthawk that they have to rehabilitate, they actually have to use a very long tweezers to carefully place those insects deep into the trachea, almost to the stomach, because these birds don't have the ability to just pick up food and swallow it. So they're used to their food just totally bypassing all the chewing and swallowing parts and just going straight into the stomach. So, you know, you do have to give them points for efficiency, and they don't have to taste their food, which may be a good thing if you eat bugs. Who knows? So according to David Sibley, if we go back to about the year 300 BCE, before the Common Era, about 2,300 years ago, it was Aristotle who first described these birds that we have written record of anyway. And he wrote about the trouble that these birds could cause with goats. Could is the key factor. And I know Aristotle was an important influence on the Western world, but to immediately make the connection of those birds with goats is probably not the first thing I would think of, but because he was Aristotle and he had some influence, this prevailing wisdom remained. It also didn't help that, or doesn't help that nightjars are nocturnal or fly usually at night. A lot of the nightjars in Western Europe are nocturnal. And so they kind of hid in this shroud of nighttime mystery, just like the bats. And we don't really know a lot about them. And it is quite possible that when goats were moving around in a field, they were kicking up insects. And so, you know, I guess the most plausible story here is that Aristotle and others saw flocks of nighthawks hanging around the goats at night, and one thing led to another, and today they're still called the goat suckers. It was 77 AD that Pliny the Elder made this description. The caprimulgi, or so-called of milking goats, are like the bigger kind of owsels, which are thrushes. They be night thieves, for all the day long they see not. Their manner is to come into the sheep herds, cotes, and goat pens, and to the goats' udders presently they go, and suck the milk at their teats. And look what udder is so milked, it giveth no more milk, but misliketh and falleth away afterwards, and the goats become blind withal. So Pliny took that goat connection a little further, based on Aristotle's concern that the bird could cause trouble with goats, and he postulated that the nightjars kind of snuck past the shepherds, the goat herds, to the flocks of goats and sheep, and sucked at their teats under the cover of night, because who would do it in the daytime? And if that wasn't enough, they rendered that teat useless and caused the goats to go blind. So he goes on to reveal, when I was in Switzerland, I saw an aged man who fed his goats upon the mountain, which I had gone up in search for plants. I asked him whether he knew of a bird the size of a marilla, which is a Eurasian blackbird, blind in the daytime, keen of sight at night, which in the dark is wont to suck goats' udders, so that afterwards the animals go blind. Now he replied that he had suffered many losses from those very birds, so that he had once had 6 she-goats blinded, but possibly that aged man was jesting with me. So the legend was started by the Greeks, carried on by the Romans, and made its way into modern society, which sometimes is just how things work. Strangely, night jars aren't the only nighttime goat harassing legend out there. Many Latinx communities in Puerto Rico, Mexico, and the US tell the story of the chupacabra that also translates to goat sucker. Again, you have the cabra or capra and the chupar, which translates to suck. Only this goat sucker is somewhat more sinister and doesn't suck the milk out of the goat's teat. It sucks the goat's blood. And sightings of the chupacabra have been reported as far north as Maine and as far south as Chile. So we are definitely in the range of both types of goat suckers here in Wisconsin. And as you can see from this drawing, the chupacabra has also been sighted as far as Russia. It probably took the Bering Strait over from Alaska and then also made its way down into Indonesia. For most of my life, there were a wide variety of birds that were lumped into this order, Caprimulgiformes, including some familiar favorites like the hummingbirds and swifts, to which they're fairly closely related, and a lesser known group called the tree swifts. And all of these birds, including the goat suckers, these birds are now in their own order, which is the Apodiformes. And Apodiformes means no feet, because all the birds in this group have either extremely reduced or weak feet. They don't run around, they don't grasp things, and the nighthawks are the same way. But instead, all these birds with really weak feet are expert flyers and rarely need to use their feet. They're capable of doing just about everything they need to in flight, except for sleeping. There are some groups of birds that can sleep while flying, but not these birds. So they do need to use their feet to occasionally perch, especially at night. But other than that, all of these birds have very weak feet. The Caprimulgiformes also used to include the owlet night jars, which is just a fascinating looking specimen and kind of reminds me of some of the mammals that hop around in Madagascar. The group also used to include the tawny frog mouths, which is a hybrid between Godzilla and a Jim Henson Muppet, and is also a bird that likes to play the game, "Where did my head go?" I'm sure we've all played that before. And the Caprimulgiformes also used to include the oil bird, which is an absolutely fascinating bird that is the only nocturnal fruit-eating bird that, like a bat, uses echolocation to navigate caves in South America in complete and total darkness. But of all the groups of the birds that used to be in Caprimulgiformes, nothing compares to, in my opinion, the potus. They are masters of camouflage by day. They pretend to be part of a tree. I'll give you a few seconds here to both try to make out where the bird is, and then once you find it, another few seconds to just marvel at that disguise of being a little stump of a tree. Here's a couple more that are slightly more obvious to where the bird is. And just when you thought it couldn't get any better, here is a mama and a baby potu. So I don't know if you, of course. So, well, then the next thing is that, these adorable potus cannot keep their eyes shut forever. And at some point they have to open their eyes. And this becomes, oh, here's another mama and a baby. But when they open their eyes, it becomes a true gift of nature to us. And I will let the next few slides just speak for themselves. So if you ever need a pick-me-up, just Google potu images. That's P-O-T-O-O. So I spent a little more time talking about all the birds that used to be in the order Caprimulgiformes because they're just so awesome. But the most recent ordering of birds moved all of these groups I just talked about into their own order. So they're no longer with the nightjars. If we take the next step in the family tree, we move from the order Caprimulgiformes to the family Caprimulgidae, and there are many, many descriptive names for the birds in this family, and you'll often hear the term nightjar, Nightjar often refers to the old world species in Eurasia and Africa and Australia. In the Americas, we tend to use the word nighthawk a little bit more, even though, again, they're not hawks. So here are two members of the family that you may be familiar with, the whippoorwill on the left and the chuckwill's widow on the right, two birds that are fairly, very rarely seen, but often heard, especially if you go to the Shakespeare in the park, Shakespeare out in western Wisconsin, often hear them then. If you're lucky, you'll get a little whippoorwill right outside your window. It sings loudly and for hours on end throughout the night. Whippoorwill, whippoorwill, whippoorwill. Or you might get a chuckwill's widow, chuckwill's widow, chuckwill's widow. I don't know who Chuck or Will are, but they both seem to have reached some bad luck. And the whippoorwill on the left is demonstrating a common behavior of the nighthawks that when they perch and hunker down during the day, they often orient their body parallel along a branch for camouflage, where most birds will orient themselves perpendicular based on how their feet work to the branch. I think the only time I've ever seen a whippoorwill was during the day. I've heard them at night, but the only time I saw them, my good friend Bill Miller somehow found one perched in a really big tree, an oak tree down in southern Illinois. The common nighthawk is one of six species in the genus Cordales, which are all found in the Americas and includes the sand-colored nighthawk, the Antillean nighthawk, and the Nacunda nighthawk of South America. It also includes the lesser nighthawk and the least nighthawk. And to those birds, I say, hold your head up high, your beautiful camouflaged heads, hold them up high because there's nothing lesser or least about you. You're greater and greatest, no matter what anyone else says. So we finally arrived at the bird of the day. The common nighthawk, Cordales minor. And Cordales translates from Greek to lyre note in the evening, which meant to refer to the evening call of the bird at twilight. And it was described by William Swainson of Swainson's Hawk and Swainson's Thrush and Swainson's Warbler fame, a guy that really liked to name a lot of birds after himself. There is a little confusion about the translation because it could also mean evening dance, but either way, it's cool because they have both an evening call and an evening dance. In fact, the best translation I've ever found for Cordales is an evening dance with music. The species name minor was given by the Western scientists that compared this bird with the only other known member of this family at the time, the European nightjar, which is in a different genus. So the common nighthawk is just a bit smaller than the European nightjar, even though the wingspan is longer, but even so, it was forever the moniker minor. As for the English name, common nighthawk, we've already debunked that. It's not common, although to be fair, it is the most common nighthawk in the United States. It doesn't fly at night, rather it's crepuscular, meaning it's active at dawn and dusk, which, fun fact, most bats could probably be better described as crepuscular than nocturnal. In fact, on some of the recent bat surveys with Dan and Ethan, which we do just after sunset, we've also come across quite a few nighthawks. But if you were to go out in the middle of the night, you likely wouldn't see any nighthawks, or maybe not even bats for that matter, because both of those groups are most active around sunset and sunrise. And we know they're not hawks. But when you look at them in flight, it is easy to see why some would call them hawks, hawks of the night. They are masters of flight. Their long, pointy wings gives them excellent control of the airways, like little fighter pilots. And they do have a very similar wing shape to some of the other masters of flight, like the falcons, like this Merlin. They're eating insects, so they often have to make pinpoint turns at the last second, which gives the observer the feel that nighthawks fly somewhat erratically. And we know of another group of animals that eats flies that also flies erratically, bats. So most people would also describe bat flight as flappy and erratic. And since both of these animals are competing for the same food and often at the same time, it makes sense that their flight patterns are very similar. Flappy erratic flight is a good adaptation for catching insects on the wing. And this photo also demonstrates one of the most salient field marks of this bird, those bold white stripes that can be seen on each wing. And you can usually see this even in poor lighting conditions. So between the erratic flight and those nice white stripes, this bird is usually pretty easy to identify. Another characteristic that identifies nighthawks pretty quickly, actually, is their call. So it's described as a nasal peent, very similar to the peent of the woodcock. And you can often hear this characteristic call as the sun is setting and rising. And we'll listen to it in a minute, but I'm going to imagine that few, if any of us, have ever heard the courtship boom of the nighthawk. So during the breeding season, males do a flight display to kind of accompany their vocal peents, where they fly high in the air and they dive down to the ground. And at the very last second, when it looks like all hope is gone and they're going to experience a spectacular crash into the ground, they extend their wings and pull up, which probably produces a lot of G's, but it also produces this boom sound, which is it's a mechanical sound that's made by air that's rushing through their feathers. So the similarities between the nighthawk and the American woodcock are pretty striking. So they're both very well camouflaged. They're both ground nesting birds. They're both active at dawn and dusk. Their peent call is almost indistinguishable from each other. And they both do these iconic aerial courtship displays that involve hurling their bodies toward the ground and making noises with their feathers. There are quite a few differences between the birds, but for two birds that are unrelated, there are a lot of similarities. So the timing of the year is different. The woodcocks eat worms instead of aerial bugs. But there are a lot of similarities between these unrelated birds. And woodcock have very strong legs and feet. If the courtship display of the nighthawk is successful and the female shows interest, the two will land on the ground next to each other and he will switch to a different ground display, which is more of like a rocking body back and forth display, which again, the timberdoodle also does, the American woodcock. So they kind of rock their body back and forth, bulge out their throat, spread their wings, and if the female likes that, they'll go on to mate. So this video from Cornell does a good job pointing out both the peent call that we've all heard and then the boom call that I've never heard. So you have to listen closely for that boom call. One person described it as kind of the sound of an Indy race car that rushing past you very quickly. So it's very quick, and it's made by the rush of air through the wings rather than through vocals. So we will take a listen.
I was up on this ridge, out in sagebrush habitat, south of Malheur National Wildlife Refuge in eastern Oregon. The sun hadn't been up very long, maybe a half an hour, and there were nighthawks up in the air, several males displaying. The calling and booming are typically heard at dawn and early evening. The nasal peent is a call that is given in flight, and then you hear what sounds like a truck roaring by that suddenly just disappears. And that's a mechanical sound produced as the bird goes into a dive. Air rushes through the primary feathers. And as it comes out of the dive, the rushing of air ceases and the boom suddenly stops. The common nighthawk is a really graceful, aerodynamic bird. It has a fairly slender, tapered body, a very small bill, almost inconspicuous, long tapered wings with white blazes right in the bend of the wing or the wrist of the wing. So as they fly in good light conditions, you see these blazes of white flash as the wings are raised and lowered. (Clears throat) what I hadn't experienced up to that point was the males coming down, diving within a meter of the ground, within 3 feet of the surface. What had been a distant experience, spectacular experience, hearing them call and watching them chasing one another, actually becoming a very intimate experience within meters of where I was standing. It's a really fascinating display to watch.
So I don't know if you're able to hear that that boom, but let's see. Okay. An interesting characteristic of the common nighthawk and other members of its subfamily is that they don't have rictal bristles. So on the left, on the upper left, this is a European nightjar, and you can see these kind of coarse black hairs around the top of its bill. You'll also see this in many flycatchers, and they're thought to kind of act like cat whiskers to help make last minute maneuvers to catch an insect, or they might even act to help kind of like funnel insects into the mouth. The nighthawks apparently don't need this extra help. In fact, so they don't have rictal bristles. In fact, it's thought that they scoff at birds with rictal bristles, kind of like a kid who's riding a bike without training wheels, looking down at their brother who still needs them. Like, hey, look at me, I don't need rictal bristles to help me catch insects. But further study is needed to determine if this feeling of superiority among nighthawks is accurate. Common nighthawks are also very old, as a species. Their fossils date back to 400,000 years ago when they were hanging out with giant sloths and woolly mammoths and glyptodons. I've mentioned that they're excellent flyers, and when you look at their range map and see their migration patterns, you kind of see why they have to be. They have quite a long way to go in migration. They're one of the longest migrators, and sometimes for reasons we don't yet understand, like a lot of birds, they'll make mistakes during migration and get blown off course. So they have shown up in places like Greenland and Iceland and the British Isles. Also in recent weeks, some of my friends like Tori have reported that they've seen nighthawks in huge numbers during the day. And this is the time to see them because many of them migrate by day in very large numbers. So keep an eye out for them in the coming weeks as they continue to migrate through. We are just past the peak migration, but you can see them throughout September and even into early October, at least here in Milwaukee. Unfortunately, nighthawks have been declining throughout most of their range, and there are likely several factors contributing to this decline. So first of all, and maybe the primary factor is aerial insectivores in general have been on the decline throughout the world, which may be due to an overall decline in aerial insects, their food, which may be the result of increased pesticide use in agriculture. But this group of birds and these insects are pretty hard to study, so it's not easy to point a direct finger at one thing in particular that could be leading to their overall decline. Another trait that makes nighthawks vulnerable is that they are ground nesters. So they're quite vulnerable to predators, especially in urban areas. Outdoor cats are very good at finding them. There's essentially no nest preparation. They almost literally just plop their eggs on the ground. And I'm sure there's some discerning as to where they plop their eggs on the ground, but some just put them directly on rocks. Other moms give their young ones a bit of a break by finding some softer gravel or maybe lichen, but otherwise the chicks hatch and hang out in a nice soft pile of rocks, which in this case does offer a bit of camouflage since they kind of look like little rocks. And after the young hatch, mom will eat some of the eggshell to restore the calcium that she lost. And then what she doesn't eat, she'll carry far away from the nest and drop it so they were not attracting predators to the nesting site. So nesting on the ground makes them vulnerable to nest predators, but they've also had to deal with loss of suitable nesting habitat. They don't like to nest in agricultural land like some other birds do. And agricultural land dominates many landscapes. And for a while, humans gave them some artificial nesting sites when flat top gravel roofs were in favor in style. But what humans gave, they can also take away, and flat top gravel roofs are not as popular as they once were. Killdeer similarly took advantage of flat top roofs for nesting along with nighthawks. So if you take increased predation, loss of habitat, loss of prey due to insecticides, and add to that the factors that all the birds are dealing with, climate change, towers and tall buildings that can interfere with their flight and cause collisions, roads and cars, all the things, you can just see how vulnerable nighthawks are. And it's like a combination of all these factors that are driving the population decrease. So if you want to know what you can do to help nighthawks and many other birds, you know, paying attention to what's going on in your neighborhood, attend your neighborhood meetings or government meetings, advocate for smart conservation practices, don't use pesticides and fertilizers, and keep your cats indoors. So we started with words and we'll end with words. I guess if you take that literally, that's no different from any talk, but we started with explaining why the bird, the common nighthawk, is not really a common hawk that flies at night. Then we moved on to a much cooler name for the birds, the goatsuckers, which, by the way, is a 2009 independent film that could have been my opening slide. But there are a few other fun descriptive words. Some people have called nighthawks the burnt land bird. And this is really cool. When fire goes through a habitat, not to the extent brought about by climate change, but natural fires that go through a habitat, the vegetation obviously changes drastically and immediately. But then there's this slow, gradual, and predictable pattern of succession as nature kind of reclaims that burnt area. Some species require fire, like some of the pines. And pioneer plant species are usually the first to arrive. They start to add the green color back to this charred landscape. And then that paves the way for other plants and animal communities. And you get the insects back that start to feed the other members of the community. And eventually you go through this progression and you either continue that progression until you're at a climax community, which around here would be a maple beech or an oak hickory, or until another disturbance comes around. So common nighthawks are one of the few birds that actually seek out and prefer recently burned areas for nesting. So this habit earned them the moniker burnt land bird. They've also been called the bull bat, bull for that low booming sound they make during the courtship flight, and bat for their erratic bat-like flight. They've been called the mosquito hawk, joining an illustrious list of other birds named for what they eat, which includes the sparrow hawk, the duck hawk, the pigeon hawk, and the chicken hawk. And they've also been called the moth hunter. And one of my other favorite names for this bird, and who knows why, is called pork and beans, the pork and beans bird. So maybe it's the same people who named them butter butts or timber doodles or whatever, but the pork and beans, I haven't found an explanation for that. They've often been called simply the bug eaters, which may have led to the little known fact, at least little known to me, that Nebraska's state nickname was once the bug eater state, and its people were known as bug eaters. In fact, Nebraska's sports team, before they were called the Cornhuskers, they were the, you guessed it, the Nebraska bug eaters. And if you don't believe me, you can watch the documentary. But the name thankfully still lives on in one of Nebraska's semi-professional soccer teams, the Bug Eaters. So there you have it. And that brings to a close my series of stories on the nightjar. And we will end with a slide that answers the age-old question, how does a nighthawk drink water? And this shows you how they drink water. Because remember, they can't swallow. So we can wonder at this while we listen to the song Come Down in Time by Elton John, which includes lyrics that Sting said was one of his all-time favorite lines in any song, one that he wishes he had written: a cluster of nightjars singing out of tune. So let's take a listen here.
quiet silent seconds I turned off the light switch and I came down to meet you in the half light the moon left while off a cluster of nightjars sang some songs out of tune. A mantle of bright light shone down from a room. Come down in time, I still hear her say so clear in my ear, like it was today. Come down in time.
All right. Well, thank you all. I will stop sharing my screen here.